to us. He came, he spoke on October 23rd in 2016. You can see his prior signature in our guest book. And he then spoke to us about the work and the book that he had then just published on, it's called The Business of Good, on social entrepreneurship. He returns, he is indeed a social entrepreneur himself. He established a real estate firm, social entrepreneur real estate firm, Rubicon, which has since been taken over by Warburg. Obviously, he's a writer. He's also a teacher. And it's his work, it came out of his work at John Jay College that he became interested in the intersection between the work of Jane Jacobs and Robert Moses, the subject of our talk today. So please join me in a very warm welcome to Jason Haber. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for having me back. As I think about it, the last time I was here, so it was October 23rd, 2016, and after I gave the lecture, we finished in taking some questions, and someone asked me, by what margin would Hillary Clinton win in 2 weeks? And I forgot about that, probably blocked it out. But it's important for our conversation for today, actually. Because today we're going to be speaking about this intersection between the worlds of politics, government, and what happens when those institutions break down. There are three things we'll be talking about today and how they intersect. The first is the city, the second is democracy itself, and the third is power and the power structure of the city. And of course, we're talking about Robert Moses, but I want to begin by making something very clear, because there's this new movement afoot, I don't know if you've seen it, where people are saying things like, oh, you know, he got things built, he got a lot of things done, and if you are in that camp and you share that view, I would recommend that you leave now and go catch Meet the Press. This is not going to be the place for you. In our story today, we're going to be talking about a certain kind of corruption, but not the kind of corruption that we're used to. We're used to corruption being dollars. The corruption that we're going to talk about today is a different kind of currency. In many ways, it's more pernicious. It's the currency of power. And so, like everyone, when I was a young urban planner, I read The Power Broker. It's a million words in its first draft. It was so big they had to cut it down to 700,000 words. And after reading 700,000 words, I said to myself, now I know everything there is to know about New York in the 20th century and urban planning. Here's a copy of my book. And I'd like audience participation. If you could just turn to the page, please, that references Jane Jacobs. It's a very smart crowd we have here this morning. You can stop right there before you go through all 1,000 pages. There is no reference to Jane Jacobs in the book. And so the truth is there's probably, by the way, I get that back, right? there's no one source of, because it's such a dense topic, that can summarize the totality of what we're going to talk about today. But Jane Jacobs, the first myth I want to dispel about her right now is the myth that goes a little something like this. Jane Jacobs, comma, what comes next? Jane Jacobs, the housewife. You see, this comes up time and time again, and you'll see it, by the way, unfortunately, in contemporary writing too. Jane Jacobs, a housewife, did X, Y, and Z. Now, she did have children, she did raise them, but it's this bias against her that we still see to this very day that tries to bring her down as being something less than some sort of, you know, impressive person, which of course, she was throughout her career. She was a writer. When she first started writing, she wrote about the perils of Lincoln Center, causing the head of a magazine to ask, who is this crazy dame? And this would follow her again and again and again. Now, it's easy to say now, today, Jane Jacobs was right. It's another thing, however, to say that Jane Jacobs has won. Because when you look at the power structure of democracy, city, and governance, you can tell me Jane Jacobs is right, but in many ways, the fact that Jane Jacobs has won is a question mark is more important, because if Jane Jacobs won, why is it that we have towers that cast shadows on Central Park. If Jane Jacobs won, why is it that our mass transit system is literally falling apart? If Jane Jacobs won, why is it that our public housing is also in crisis? And we can argue all we want about the failure of our leaders of today, but I argue that the original sin lies with Robert Moses. And in many ways, we're still paying the devil his due. Now, if you just look at the world and say, well, you know, building it is an accomplishment, then he's your guy. And some people to this day think that. At least he got it built, and that's what we need today, a real commitment to get things done. I mean, consider the source, but still. He said this while he was the governor. Here's another one. Would Robert Moses succeed today? Of course he would. He was a brilliant builder and a leader accustomed to wielding power creatively. Moses would understand the intricacies of today's rules and use his substantial intellect to manipulate and stretch law to his own purposes. I agree with the second part, but that's not a positive thing, what we want. And lastly, he was a man whose power emanated not only from his significant personal skill, but from his phenomenal level of accomplishment. While many today have criticized him for his authoritarian rule, no one can question the permanent impact he had on the framework and infrastructure of New York State. Again, we're talking about the city, the people who live in the city. We're talking about the 8 million people here. We're talking about democracy, those men who govern and have governed us. And we're talking about power to the 8 million people who live in here. Now, what happens when all three things break down? You see, great public works, when they work at their best, they draw people in. Moses and other planners are very fond of calling all of their projects, their roads, arterial highways. But the very fact that they call them arterial roads tells you all you need to know. For what does an artery do? It takes away from the heart. It draws away. The best projects are veins. They draw life and energy into the heart, into the city. And for that reason, I want to start our story today in 1825. Why 1825? Well, some millennials believe this is the year that Facebook was founded. It's not the case, I promise them, I promise you. But it is the reason we start our story with Mayor and Governor and also Senator DeWitt Clinton. So in 1817, Governor Clinton proposed a canal system. A canal would rise across upstate New York to connect New York to the emerging West, to all the rivers and tributaries across the growing country. Now, it was seen as a folly. They actually called the Erie Canal Clinton's Ditch, Clinton's Folly. He was so ridiculed for it in 1822, he was voted out of office because it was conceived as such a failure. In 1820, there were 123,000 people living in the city of New York. It was the biggest city in the country, but only narrowly ahead of Philadelphia and Boston. Just remember this number for a moment. 1825 rolls around. Here's the canal here, which runs across the Hudson and connects to the Great Lakes. And then from the Great Lakes, goods and services can be shipped down the Mississippi and Ohio rivers and connect to all of the cities across the country. It costs $7.1 million. In 1826, it already had returned its initial investment, and its entire cost was paid off. The canal wasn't even finished yet, and yet it paid for itself. So just to show you what it did, so it cost $125 per ton, and it would take 45 days for a good to leave New York and reach the Midwest. Now with the canal, that same good is shipped at $6 per ton and in 9 days. By 1853, 62% of all commerce in the United States runs through New York City. And what do you think that does to New York? It does this: 10 times growth in 40 years. That's urban planning at its best. Smartly thought of, controversial, but it worked. A few years later, this is the picture of the Brooklyn Bridge being built, about right over here. This man's born. Who's this? Al Smith. So Al Smith was born on 174 South Street. And the Al Smith story is important to us today and outside of this room because the Al Smith story is the story of the power of immigrants and why immigrants are so important to our country. Al Smith, his father died when he was 13 years old. They were so poor that his mother went to the funeral in the morning and in the afternoon had to go to work because there were no protections back then. She couldn't lose her job. He worked at the Fulton Fish Market, never graduated college, never graduated high school. Couldn't afford either. And he's working in the docks. Not many people thought he would amount to much. He eventually has this loud, booming voice. He gets appointed different positions. Eventually, the Tammany Hall guys think he's perfect for the assembly. Goes up to Albany. No one expects very much of him. And then March 25th happens. We just had the anniversary that was commemorated last week. 146 people died in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. And most of them were ages between 14 and 23. The average worker earned about $7 a week, the equivalent of about $3.20 today. The reason this is important is Al Smith is given the position of chairing the investigative committee to look into the fire, and he launches a series of reforms. And Al Smith, the Tammany man, becomes Al Smith, the reformer, because he lived the immigrant life, and he understood what immigrants were going through in this country. He could bring about reforms, and he knew their story better than anyone else could have imagined. And that changed things for Al Smith, who becomes the Speaker of the Assembly, he becomes the governor, and he becomes our first presidential candidate eventually to run as a Catholic and also as an immigrant. This picture over here on the right was part of a campaign they did. They had license plates in Al Smith's name. And I actually have the one that belonged to Al Smith here, if you want to see it afterwards. This was, I should probably hold this with gloves. This was a gift from Al Smith's great grandson to me a few years back after he heard me speak. So the Al Smith story is important for two other reasons for us pressing right now. He had two young aides. The first one, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. The second one, Robert Moses. So Moses comes to power with Al Smith. In his early career, he's actually a reformer, and people forget this. He first comes to City Hall with this idea of creating a municipal grading system where he's going to grade employees, and if you have a failing grade, you could be removed from office. Tammany doesn't like this. They get rid of young Robert Moses, and he can't find a job. He applies for a job in Cleveland, actually, and didn't even get it. But he comes back to power with Al Smith, and now he's a changed person because the reformer in him is gone, and now he's looking at, with all of his big dreams, the execution of his big dreams, which to him didn't mean reform. He starts with parks. Specifically, his first public work is Jones Beach. So it's hard to imagine it today, but in 1929 America, there's no such thing, or even in the world, as a beach for everyone. The beaches were for the 1% on Long Island, they were for the 1% of the 1%. There were immense obstacles in building Jones Beach. It was too low, it would flood, so they had to raise it 12 feet. It was windy, so they had to build sand dunes. Every problem he overcame and built this, what was a masterpiece in 1929. Here's a picture of him swimming along the beach. He was a lifelong swimmer. I was talking to someone earlier about who caught him swimming in the 1970s off of these waters. Opening day in Jones Beach. This is what it looked like. When my daughter, Michaela, who's here with us today, saw this photo, she said, "How did you find your car?" It's the black one. The other thing that's so interesting about opening day on Jones Beach is the Wantagh Parkway traffic, which would also come. But it's also, if we go back and look at the photos again, it's who's there. It's also who's not there, because Jones Beach was not a beach for everyone. Long Island was a blank canvas, right? There was basically no one, very few people living out there in the 1920s. Why in the world were the overpasses set to 7.7 feet? Very, very specific reason. The buses of the day were 12 feet high, and they would not be able to access Jones Beach, and that's important because in 1929 America, African-American car ownership was under 1%. It kept Jones Beach a white enclave for its first 30 years. This is done on purpose, and the reason this is important is when we have so much power vested in one person who's also a racist, we're going to see racist policies emerge large and small in ways that we don't think about today, but that are very real And institutional racism has terrible, terrible effects. New York City in the 1930s has three great storm clouds approaching it. The first is the Great Depression, the second is corruption, and the third is the rise of the modernists. Now, the Great Depression hits America hard everywhere. Nowhere was harder hit than here in New York, where unemployment hovered around 30%. Bread lines were everywhere. People were living in the parks. When I first showed this photo to my students in, I think it was 2007, one of them aptly noted in the picture, even the dog is white. At the same time, our mayor was Jimmy Walker, a very dashing man who ran a casino in Central Park. The city was so hurt during the Depression, partially because of the corruption was so high that the public monies weren't even getting to the people. Eventually, Mayor Walker's charged with corruption, but he's so debonair that the lead prosecutor was told, don't look him in the eye at trial because he'll charm you. And so the prosecutor, Seabury, actually looked to his stood at the side so he couldn't look in the eye of Walker, as you see there in the photo. The next mayor who comes in was also a corrupt Tammany man. When asked by the media who the next police commissioner would be, he simply replied, they haven't told me yet. But finally, a fusion ticket emerges, and out of this chaos, we get one of the great mayors in the history of the city, Mayor LaGuardia. Now, Mayor LaGuardia did many great things during his time in office, but he also brings to power in New York City Robert Moses, who was first set to the Triborough Bridge chairman in 1932. Now, Triborough is very important to our story today. It's a massive undertaking. They started building it in 1916, much to no avail. Entire forests of trees had to be chopped down just to make it work. It turns out to be the biggest public works project of them all. It costs more than the Hoover Dam. Some of the steel imported in 1935 came from Germany, which, if you know a little thing about history, probably not the best place to be importing steel from. LaGuardia rejected the Moses contract, saying the only commodity we get from Hitlerland is hatred, and sent the steel back to Germany. But the bridge gets built, and at the time it's considered a marvel, but here's the thing. The way the bridge gets built is by the use of the public authority law, and Moses inserts language deep within this bill that no one else bothers to read, which gives him the power and control over the purse behind the bridge. So it works like this. LaGuardia imagines the bridge to be a short-term solution, meaning the authority to be a short-term solution. The authority will build the bridge, will pay for the bridge, and then will be retired, and the bridge will return to the city. Moses changes that. Moses ensures that the debt on the bridge, the way municipal finance works very simply, is like this. Let's say the bridge collects $1 million a year in revenue, he can issue bonds against that debt of, say, $20 million, and then he can keep on reissuing the bonds. The bridge is perpetually in debt, and thus he's in power. And that's exactly what Moses did. He eventually creates his own revenue stream, his own island on Randall's Island. And on that island, he has his own boats, he has his own flag, he has his own police force. The island is a country unto itself. And now Moses doesn't need elected officials for money. He has his own source of funds. They need him. In fact, he would make the mayor, the governor, pay the tribute in coin every time they wanted to come to Randall's Island. Here's opening day of the bridge. It's probably one of the few days where there wasn't traffic on it. You can't quite see it in there, but FDR is in the procession. Now, one thing I also want to point out, if you look at this on a map, sure, it makes a lot of sense at 96th Street to have here. Every time you drive 4.5 miles, you can thank Robert Moses for that. The extra 2 miles north was done because William Randolph Hearst had land that he wanted condemned, and Moses, knowing a thing or two about power, decided to let the land be condemned there and build the spur there instead of at 96th Street, where it makes much more sense. But the third crisis facing the city, and maybe in many ways the most difficult, is the rise of the modernists. So this is Le Corbusier, is a French-Swiss architect, and his ideas about order, the superblock, the highway, get misinterpreted but applied here in New York in ways they weren't done outside of the world, And in 1939, we get our first look at what the future of New York is going to be. Before there was Disneyland, there was Futurama. So in 1939, at the World's Fair, you could go in these little seats and they spun you around to see the city of the future. And this is what the modernists said was the city of the future. Now, one thing it's missing, I just want to point out, is people. There are no people. There may be some trees somewhere in there. But the idea was the highway leading through the city, the super block, the super tall building, was in some way, somehow, the future of how we were all going to live. And Robert Moses was perhaps the greatest disciple of this vision, and this is what he was going to set out to build when he had the opportunity. That opportunity came at the end of the war. In 1945, as everyone gathers in Times Square, New York takes on a very, very different tone. It's not the capital of the country, right? When we think of great cities, London, Berlin, Paris, these are all capital cities, right? New York isn't even the capital of the state. So New York's going to take on this very different form after 1945. It's going to be the capital of the world. And New York has not one thing, right? New York is everything. And by 1945, with so much commerce and activity happening in the city, it's poised for greatness. It's poised to be the great city of the 20th and 21st centuries. A modern day Athens. And yet, 30 years later, this is New York. You've seen the famous headlines, Ford to City Drop Dead, the pamphlets, some of which will be difficult to read, but Fear City, stay off the streets after 6 p.m., don't walk at night. This was the reality of New York in the 1970s. President Carter visited. This is on Charlotte Street in the Bronx. The street in 1974 became so bad that it was removed from official city maps. And Carter walked through it to see what was going on. You can see him there with A-beam. And so to understand what happened in that 30 to 40 year period, we have to understand the decisions that were made by those in power, only we come to realize there were no those in power. Those decisions were made by one man who's the focal point of our story today. Remember this though, Robert Moses is central to our story because he was never elected to any office. Some people, if you Google it, it'll come up, like Governor Robert Moses, Senator Robert Moses. He was never elected. Now, if you're an elected official and someone wants to build a highway through your neighborhood, you're going to respond to the people who are very upset about that highway being ran through your neighborhood because they'll vote in someone else. Moses has no need for voters. He doesn't care about them. He doesn't need to because he has his own power base. Now, this is not how it's supposed to work in a democracy, a government under the direct representative rule of the people. What we've seen is that democracy is much more fragile than we give it credit for. And the dangers that come in any democracy are when someone can circumvent it and pull what we'll call a Moses. And we consider that in the 20th century what happened, and I would argue that that is also our challenge this very day today. Let's just look very quickly at the positions that Moses held simultaneously. There are 12 of the 15 on here. As the parks commissioner and construction coordinator, he would propose public works. As the head of the city planning commission, he would approve what he proposed. This is not how it's supposed to work in a democracy. And yet this is exactly what happened for anyone. If you had one of these positions, it would be a career capstone. But for Moses, he held them all at the same time. Here's a list of the 52 projects that he built: 416 miles of road, 658 playgrounds, 150,000 housing units. It's $150 billion in today's spending. Now, let's take a deeper dive and just look at what happens in across three boroughs, what he built. Let's start in the Bronx and just look at the Cross Bronx Expressway, which you can see being built here. Now, you can actually see its encroachment here, which I find to be fascinating. Now, in the neighborhood of East Tremont, 1 mile was slated to be destroyed, and the neighbors said, you know what, there is another way to do this. They found an alternative that would bend the road a few miles to the south at no additional cost to the city. So they formed an organization, the East Tremont Neighborhood Association. They appointed a woman, Jane Jacobs, before Jane Jacobs, I like to call her. Lillian Edelstein was her name. And she starts lining up support against this highway. And so she gets her Congress member, her state senator, her assembly member, the comptroller, and the Bronx Borough president, but more so, she reaches out to Robert Wagner. Robert Wagner is the Manhattan Borough president, and he's running for mayor. And so he sends a letter, I'm gonna read from it, and I quote, "I want to assure you I will vote against any resolution before the Board of Estimate seeking to authorize acquisition of that property." And then again, on October 14th of 1952, he says, "I will vote against any resolution," he tells an audience, much to their happiness. And so then on April 23rd, 1953, the Board of Estimate gathers to vote. And Moses walks in, and he looks around the room, and all these people from East Tremont, New York are there, and he gleans at them, "You small, small, stupid people. You think you're going to usurp me." He whispers into the ear of every member of the Board of Estimate, and you probably know the answer to this question. So the destruction that follows is similar to what you would find in Europe at the time during the rebuild, only we did it here to ourselves. And when you put roads ahead of people, when you're going to make going through a city more important than who lives in the city, and if today's talk has so far had an impact on you, then this photo will be upsetting. Moses was asked if this was difficult for the people in the community, and he said, "Oh, no, no, they just stirred up the animals there. It was easy, I just stood pat, no hardship at all." And the reason he's able to get away with this is more broadly, we're in the era of the car. The car is democracy in the mid part of the 20th century. I can get in my car and I can go anywhere I want. I don't have to follow your train schedule. I don't have to sit with other people. I have freedom. I have a car. I'll go my own way. And that is the thinking of the most glorious car in a generation, the mighty Chrysler. This is the thinking of where we were going as a society. And if we're going this way, the car and the road, that means there have to be other sacrifices made. And in Manhattan, we see the greatest sacrifice of the car that was ever made. And so this is the original, as many of you know, Penn Station, built at the turn of the century, built to last 1,000 years. It lasted about 60. One of the few things left standing are the railings that are still there. That's tracks 17 and 16, which are actually still there. Everything else is, of course, gone. Probably the greatest piece of architecture ever built in the history of this country. And it came down very, very slowly without any honor. And it comes apart in pieces. It takes much longer than the planners had envisioned. Of course, now we have a basketball team that wins 15 games a year there and an ugly office tower. But society, it was written, we're not judged by what we create, but what we destroy, and if so, what a heavy judgment that this is. So the statues were scattered. This one ended up in a landfill in New Jersey. There's one of them that is still outside today on the 7th Avenue side. There's another one that's in Hicksville at the Long Island Railroad stop there. I think those are the only two that survived. So we lost a train station, we've lost a community in the Bronx, and now at 6 o'clock this morning I realized I wanted to add one more in. We lost a baseball team. So the Brooklyn Dodgers are important not just because they played baseball, but because of what they meant to the borough, to the city, but also what they did for society. Because in 1947, with the promotion of Jackie Robinson, they become the first team in the league to desegregate. And the Dodgers, which are known as the bums because they always lose, suddenly start winning. And in 1955, they win it all. And they become the champions. The problem is Ebbets Field is built in 1916, and there's no place for parking because there weren't that many cars then. No problem, says Walter O'Malley. There's a perfect site in Brooklyn where they could move to. They just need city approval to do so. They commission a new stadium design. This would have had a dome. This would have been right where the Barclays Center is today, just across the street from it. It's a perfect site. However, Robert Moses is building for the World's Fair in Queens and says, no, we're going to build you a municipal stadium in Queens. Going to Queens was like going to the moon or like going to Los Angeles, which is where they went, and a deal that was too good for them to turn down. Walter O'Malley got the blame, but it's truly Robert Moses who let the Dodgers go to Los Angeles. They painted the wrecking ball as a baseball, which was pretty sad. And this is Roy Campanella, who came back that last day when it was going to be demolished, the second African-American player on the Dodgers. And then the stadium gets torn down. And so here we have $150 billion. I showed you 52 projects. I showed you things that were built and things that were taken down. What's the result, right? Like, what happened? Well, in 1940, we had a population of 7.4 million. In 1980, we had a population of 7 million. This is astounding. In 400 years of history, 400 years, there is not one 40-year period where we had population decline in New York City. Wars didn't reduce our population. Plagues didn't reduce our population. But Robert Moses did. And so, who stands up to Moses if the politicians won't? Let's enter Jane Jacobs into our story, who first comes across Robert Moses when the geniuses decided that what we need in Washington Square Park is a four-lane highway. This is 1958, and Jane Jacobs, who didn't really know much about Robert Moses, writes a letter to the mayor who says, "My husband and I are among the citizens who truly believe in New York. It's very discouraging that we do our part to make the city more habitable than learn that the city itself designed schemes to make it more uninhabitable." She begins her career as an organizer here, organizing against the Moses plan. NYU at the time had a problem with the plan too. They said it was too narrow, that the road needed to be bigger, believe it or not. Moses gets very upset when he hears about the arguments against his fight, against his road. He says, "There's nobody against this. Nobody, nobody, nobody but a bunch of mothers." They organize the Save Our Square rally. They bring in Eleanor Roosevelt. They hold a lot of rallies. And sure enough, on November 1st, 1958, this is the last car to go through Washington Square Park. Jane Jacobs has a victory, along with the other organizers, that eluded others up in the Bronx. And so she writes about what she sees as the failure of urban planners in the death and life of great American cities. This is her at the White Horse Tavern, which is still there to this day. "Cities," she says, "have the capacity of providing something for everybody only because and only when they are created by everyone. There is no logic that can be superimposed on the city. People make it, and it is to them, not the buildings, that we must fit our plans." This is an entirely reverse way of thinking, opposite of what Robert Moses came to say and to believe. "Dull, inert cities, it is true, do contain the seeds of their own destruction and little else. But lively, diverse, intense cities contain the seeds of their own regeneration with enough energy to carry over for problems and needs outside of themselves." She's looking outside her window and she's seeing a community that's thriving, that does not need to be reinvented by modern planners. She sees the chaos as a positive. She sees that as what's worth living in a city in the first place. She calls it a ballet. And she describes the stretch of Hudson Street where I live as each day the scene of an intricate sidewalk ballet. I make my own first entrance into a little after eight when I put my garbage can and surely the prosaic occupation, but I enjoy my part. My little dang as the junior droves of junior high school students drop by the center of the stage dropping candy wrappers. We have done this many a morning for more than 10 years and we both know what it means. All is well. Meaning that natural flow is what makes life exciting and right and good in the city. When the book came out, the first review in The New Yorker says, Mother Jacobs Home Remedies. Again, Mother Jacobs. This happens again and again and again. Now, Jane Jacobs calls city life a ballet, but there are problems too with the ballet. One of them is the cost. Not everyone can afford a ballet. And we see that happening across the village, which is one of our challenges today. When things like beloved bookstores become bookstores occupied by Marc Jacobs, which is why people now say, more Jane Jacobs, less Marc Jacobs. Now, Jane Jacobs notes that despite all the challenges facing not just New York City, but America during the 1960s, it's not drugs, it's not crime, but it's something much more basic that's the cause of our problems in the city. It's the car. The car, the car, the car. And the problems that we have today are we put the car ahead of mass transit, we built roads. You know, the Futurama exhibit that I showed you earlier, that was underwritten by General Motors. I mean, we're basically subsidizing the growth of General Motors by building highways for more cars. And all we're doing is creating more and more and more traffic. And then a few years later, Robert Moses decides that the West Village, of all places, is blighted. And so these blocks here, some of the most expensive real estate in New York, will be torn down and put in their place super high-rises on super tall structures. And Jane Jacobs goes right back to work. She organizes, she puts X's outside the buildings that were zoned to be blighted. She has people walking around with their glasses, with X's on their glasses. She gets celebrities, she gets people involved. And once again, the blight is canceled. This is actually her, where she lived, at 555 Hudson Street. And they get the Urban Renewal Project killed. But then comes the biggest project of them all, the one that's our biggest fight, the one that would change New York like no other, and that's this. If you're wondering where the Lower Manhattan Expressway is, luckily it doesn't exist. This is Broome Street right here. So this would have connected from the Holland Tunnel to the Williamsburg and Manhattan bridges. It would have taken an 8-lane highway right through what is today Soho, and this was basically at one point a done deal. This is why Soho in the 1960s was in such decay, because homeowners didn't want to keep up their homes if they were going to be subject to eminent domain and destroyed. Here's a bit of how it would have looked, sort of looked, and the chaos that would have followed. Here's a picture of some of the protests that were organized. So at one hearing, Jane Jacobs comes to it and the microphone is facing out into the audience. Now on stage are members of the Department of Transportation. So Jane Jacobs walks up and, like, I'm facing all of you, she starts to speak, but of course she notes at a public hearing, she's supposed to be addressing the elected officials and the appointed officials, not the audience. So she says, I want to speak to the people who are voting on this. So they come down off the stage, they turn the mic around, she faces them, she turns the mic back around and says, I'd rather speak to my friends. And then she rallies the crowd into such passion, they storm the stage, the stenographer's notes fall apart, they say there's no hearing, and Jane Jacobs is arrested in this rather iconic photo for disturbing the peace. But she was relentless in her work against the highway, and elected officials begin to speak against it. One quote that I always like from Assemblyman Luis DeSalvo, and I'll read it to you in its whole. Except for one old man, I've been unable to find anyone of technical competence who is for this so-called expressway. And this is an old man who is cantankerous and stubborn, who has done many things which have been, in their time, good for the city. But I think it's time for this stubborn old man to realize that too many of his dreams turn out to be nightmares for the city. And this board must kill this example of bad city planning, or the stench of it will haunt them and this great city for years to come. And in the end, this was defeated. This defeat leads to other defeats, and in 1968, Governor Rockefeller says, we have an opportunity to take out Robert Moses because you see our mass transit system, our authorities are all non-connected, they're all run by different agencies and organizations, and he says we're going to create one agency at the state level that's going to be efficient and savvy, and we're going to take Moses out of power, and ladies and gentlemen, I give you the MTA. So the MTA is created as a power grab to take Moses out of power. Is it any wonder today why the state runs our transportation? It's because of Moses, and we're still living with the problems that they created back then with our MTA today. But the story that we're telling today is also important because it reminds us of how fragile our democracy is. When I started talking earlier, I mentioned that I was here on October 23rd, and we were thinking about the future. But we should be thinking about the future now, because the likes of Moses always return. They always come back. And our democracy is just so fragile. Exactly. But all politics, all democracy is local, and it's up to each of us to remember these history lessons because we're constantly fighting them. Look, this was 2007. This was Hudson Yards. Here's an article in 2008 about the redevelopment of it. It's the second paragraph I want to draw your attention to. It was a vision to make Robert Moses proud, calling for office towers along 11th Avenue, skyscrapers soaring over a railroad, rail yard, a Parisian-style boulevard lined with trees, an expanded Jacob Javits Convention Center, and a 1.1-mile extension of the number 7 line, not to mention the elegant new Penn Station ringed by office towers. Just want to point out that the only thing Moses wouldn't have liked is the new elegant Penn Station, which never happened. The rest basically did. So in 1939, we looked at this Futurama photo, and we've recognized through Jane Jacobs and others the folly of this design. And since then, no one's dared to return a master plan to that form, to the super block, the super tall building, devoid of public small blocks and public space, until last week, when Hudson Yards opened. I suppose there's a vessel in the middle there, which maybe makes it better, I don't know. But it's important to remember we're now back to super block planning. And if you've been there to date, I just want to point out that there is actually going to be a road there where everyone stands today. And of course, the cars will be spaced out at 15 to 20 feet, you know, because there's not going to be much traffic, right? So between that debate and debates about congestion pricing, we have much to be active about our citizenry today. And I can share with you later, if you like, my own theory thinking on this. I can tell you that Robert Moses would have hated the idea of congestion pricing. Jane Jacobs wouldn't have liked the Big Brother aspect, but certainly would have liked the reduction in cars. But to be hopeful for a second, I want to go back. This is President Carter again. This is President Carter on Charlotte Street. And you see how bad the street looks. Again, I mentioned that it was taken off the city maps. This is the same street today. That's basically where Carter stood. There is not a trace today of what was once there. And that's the beauty about living in this city, that we can fix and repair. Nothing is permanent. The only thing that's permanent should be our activism as an engaged society. Someone once asked me if I could sum up Robert Moses in one sentence, which I guess would have saved you like 45 minutes of me speaking. But I can. So I said that Robert Moses' legacy is this. New York needed a Robert Moses. Instead, it got the Robert Moses. But like, we needed someone who could think about our modern needs of transportation and of housing and of planning and of beaches and of highways and of parks. But instead, we got him. And the problem is, I need you to remember that this man will return in some form or another. Jane Jacobs wrote, "We expect too much of our buildings and too little of ourselves." And so I hope it is that you take with you today a little more understanding of where we've been and what we need to do going forward to remain a healthy and thriving city. Thank you everyone for coming this morning. Really appreciate your time.